In the course of the past 3 centuries, various papyrus manuscripts were being unearthed in multiple locations in South Egypt. The mystery manuscripts are written in Coptic, an ancient language spoken in Egypt during the Roman and early Byzantine period. The contents of these manuscripts were identified as Gnostic texts. From the hidden cryptic sayings of Jesus to heavily metaphorical accounts of apocalyptic visions, are those texts secret codes awaiting to be deciphered, or just a relic of a past doctrine that once flourished? In this video, we explore some of the most enigmatic writings found in 5 Gnostic Gospels and try to unravel the mystery that is their origin and purpose. Gnosticism is a religious sect that emerged during the 1st century AD, primarily among Jewish and early Christian communities, and later formed Islamic offshoots as well. The word Gnosticism derives from the Greek gnostikos, meaning having knowledge. Gnostics believed that salvation came not through Jesus Christ nor the earthly religious authorities, but rather by means of esoteric wisdom and personal spiritual experience, referred to as gnosis. In the Gnostic worldview, physical matter is evil and flawed. It is only the unseen spiritual world that is pure. Gnostics held that the God who created our material world was a lesser deity and not the true one. He is named Yaldabaoth, or the Demiurge, often depicted with the head of a lion and a serpentine body. Instead, they believed in a higher benevolent divine being, referred to as the original creator, who is transcendent above the evil matter. Of course, Gnostic beliefs immensely conflicted with Orthodox Christianity, and they were deemed heresies by the early church. What is deeply puzzling about the Gnostic writings is that they are vastly more mystical and metaphorical than the canonical texts of the New Testament, making it frustratingly difficult to decipher exactly what they are trying to convey, as we shall see throughout this video. Among the most famous of these texts is the Gospel of Thomas. Rather than a narrative account of his life, the text is a collection of sayings attributed to Jesus that have never been widely circulated. The book ends with a very controversial verse, number 114, that depicts a conversation between Simon Peter and Jesus. Simon Peter said to them, "Make Mary leave us, for females don't deserve life." Jesus said, "I will guide her to make her male, so that she too may become a living spirit resembling you males. For every female who makes herself male will enter the kingdom of heaven." Let's just be thankful that this is an apocryphal book that has nothing to do with the current Christian canon. In another verse, Jesus speaks of himself, saying, "I am the light that is over all things. I am all. Split a piece of wood, I am there. Lift up the stone, and you will find me there." Perhaps the writer is trying to convey that Jesus is omnipresent, although the choice of words is quite unusual, to say the least. The Sophia of Jesus Christ is one of the most mystical of all Gnostic texts I've come across. It talks about the creation of gods, humanity, and the universe, and comprises 13 existential questions directed at Jesus by the disciples. Questions like why everything came to being, for instance, to which Jesus replies,
"The Great Spirit was the creator. Because of his love, he wanted to bear fruit from himself, so he would not be alone in his opulence."
Or when Thomas asked about the number of universes in existence, which Jesus cryptically answers,
"The original creator created 12 universes for the procession of the 12 angels. All these were perfect and pleasing, until the flaw in the subordinate developed."
The flaw in the subordinate might be a reference to how physical matter came about in the first place. It happened when Sophia, a lesser being than the original creator, tried to use her creative powers without referring back to him, so she accidentally created matter, along with Yaldabaoth, the malformed lesser deity, who in turn used this matter to create our world. This explains why Gnostic doctrine is opposed to the concept of matter, as it came about through a flawed act. The book is a heavily abstract read, brimming with every sort of enigmatic metaphor. You're always left wondering, what exactly is the significance of this intense symbolism? The Gospel of Philip is perhaps one of the most controversial on the list, as it contains very unprecedented references to Jesus' relationship with Mary Magdalene, to the point that other disciples start to get jealous.
The companion of the Savior is Mary Magdalene, but Christ loved her more than all the disciples and used to kiss her often on the mouth. The rest of the disciples were offended by it. They said to him, "Why do you love her more than all of us?"
Needless to say, much controversy sprung up around the celibacy of Jesus. This might actually be the verse that inspired the infamous Gospel of Jesus' Wife, a snippet of papyrus that emerged in 2012, generating media frenzy and sending shockwaves within biblical scholarship. However, after rigorous inspection of the typography and composition style, and analyzing the ink itself, it was concluded that the alleged gospel was no more than a 21st century forgery, and scholarly consensus still remains that Jesus was celibate. The Gospel of Philip also makes a very interesting claim about the creation of the world.
"The world came about through a mistake, for he who created it wanted to create it imperishable and immortal. He fell short of attaining his desire, for the world never was imperishable, nor was him who made the world."
The verse is possibly a reference to Yaldabaoth and the core Gnostic tenet that the true God can never be involved in creating something unholy like the material world, one that is full of suffering, ignorance, and separation from the divine. Another quite enigmatic Gnostic writing is the Coptic Apocalypse of Paul, which recounts a prophetic vision experienced by the apostle. Paul is on his way to Jerusalem when he meets a little child, whom he asks for directions. It turns out that the one speaking with Paul is the Holy Spirit, assuming the form of a child. The Spirit demands,
"Let your mind awaken, Paul, so that you may know the hidden things in those that are visible."
The Spirit then guides Paul through 10 heavens. The trip through the first three was not eventful, but on the fourth heaven, Paul witnesses a human soul summoned from the land of the dead and being whipped by a number of entities resembling gods. The soul is informed of the sins it perpetrated, and witnesses are brought to testify, after which the soul is cast down again to earth to dwell a body prepared for it. Embarking to the seventh heaven, Paul encounters an elderly man whose
garment was white, his throne was brighter than the sun by seven times.
The elderly divine figure tries to hinder Paul from proceeding to the heavens above. This divinity mentioned here could be a reference to the Jewish god Yahweh, and painting him in this negative light makes this book decisively Gnostic and anti-Semitic in tone. The vision ends with Paul reaching the 10th heaven, where he greets his fellow spirits. Make of that what you will. Now take a look at this ambiguous verse from the Gospel of Judas and try to imagine what it could possibly be referring to.
"Jesus said, truly I say to you, the stars complete all these things. When Sackless completes the time that's been determined for him, the first star will appear with the generations, and they will finish what's been said. Then they will sleep around in my name and murder their children."
Such a highly symbolic message opens the door to wild speculation as to the hidden meaning behind each phrase. A possible explanation to this first line could be that celestial bodies play certain roles in the fulfillment of apocalyptic events. Sackless is another Gnostic term for the demiurge, and it states here that the deity has been appointed a certain term after which a significant event will occur. What type of event? It seems to be related to the completion of some sort of grand divine plan. Could this prophecy be predicting something that will actually happen in our real world, or is it just another symbolism? Your guess is as good as mine. The murdering of children could be a metaphor for the spiritual death of upcoming generations. But who is to say if these interpretations are even close to what's originally intended? Just like this, you never know if there's a certain meaning to what you're reading, or is the text intentionally left to everyone's own interpretation and there is simply no right or wrong. The book contains further unusual teachings that entirely contradicted the early church, like in this instance when the author describes God as a luminous cloud of light, who exists in an imperishable realm, and that the first human he fashioned was one by the name of Adamas. In contrast to the canonical gospels, instead of Judas being the traitor, he is depicted as the only true disciple who correctly understood Jesus' mission and death, and that his act of betrayal was actually done in obedience to instructions given to him by Jesus himself beforehand. Practices like communion are denounced as cannibalism. It appears that the author thought that the disciples literally consumed the flesh and blood of Jesus. Countless more Gnostic texts have been found so far, both in and outside of Nag Hammadi, each offering a unique perspective on the enigmatic beliefs of the Gnostics. This video is far from scratching the surface of this deeply mystifying doctrine. The obscure origins of Gnostic texts have been heavily debated by scholars. One theory posits that the ones found in Nag Hammadi, for instance, were buried away by a Gnostic community that lived in Egypt around the 4th century in an attempt to protect them from destruction by the Orthodox Church, but others suggest that they were hidden on purpose as a way of preserving and transmitting the arcane Gnostic teachings to future generations. Due to the fact that these texts are highly nebulous and esoteric in nature, some scholars believe that they were only intended for a select group of initiates, like the famous Kopial cipher, while others argue that they may represent a unique form of mythological storytelling that was common in the ancient world. There is evidence that the texts were influenced by Eastern religions like Zoroastrianism and Buddhism. However, Gnosticism is believed by consensus to be of Jewish-Christian origins. Many Gnostic texts make references to Judaism, in some cases with a violent rejection of the Jewish God. The teachings of Paul during early Christianity might have been a starting point for Gnostic ideas, as they emphasized the disqualification of Jewish law and that the mortal body belonged to the fallen world while only the spirit could be saved, an essential theme in the Gnostic doctrine. Others venture to say that the Gnostic writings were authored by a secret society akin to the Knights Templar or the Freemasons, and that the texts contain hidden codes and symbols that reveal the secrets of these organizations. However, as of now, there is no substantial evidence to prove or disprove this claim. So, to this very day, we are not quite sure whether these texts are hidden codes awaiting to be deciphered, or just a relic of a past doctrine that once flourished. Regardless, their discovery has granted us a unique glimpse into an intriguing and complex world that's been largely forgotten in the sands of time. I had such a great time making this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it too, in which case I'd really appreciate if you helped the channel by hitting the like button and subscribing for more interesting topics like this in the future. Feel free to suggest your own topics in the comments below. I'm all ears. I'll see you in the next one.